Good afternoon. Welcome to Salem Lutheran Church and School in Afton, Missouri. My name is Pastor Wayne Huebner. With me today is Vicar Brian Novak, and our videographer is Mr. John Whitmer. It's time for the Service of Christian Witness. This service is held each year at Salem Lutheran Church and School. It's an opportunity for our 8th grade confirmands and our 8th grade students at Salem School to write and deliver essays on the confirmation verses or other significant Bible passages that have been assigned to them during this 8th grade year. It's a great opportunity for them to practice witnessing and sharing their Christian faith and what God's words and promises in our Lord Jesus Christ mean to them. We welcome you to this service. Ordinarily, we'd be doing this in person following our prayer partner luncheon, but because of the shelter-in-place restrictions this year, we'll do the Service of Christian Witness online. We invite you to follow along. The responses and text of the hymns will be displayed on the right side of the screen during the service. We invite you to participate as you are able. This service, like all services here at Salem, begins with the ringing of the Salem bells.
Christ be my Savior in calm as in strife. Death cannot hold me, for He is the life. Nor darkness, nor doubting, nor sin and its stain can touch my salvation with Jesus I
Please stand as you are able for the words of the invocation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Amen. I am the Good Shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into His presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to Him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture and the sheep of his hand. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. I am the Good Shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Let us pray. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, because of your tender love toward us sinners, you have given us your Son, that believing in him, we might have everlasting life. Continue to grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may remain steadfast in this faith to the end, and finally come to life everlasting through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. Revelation chapter 2, verse 10. My name is Grayson Barnett. I am getting confirmed at Salem Lutheran Church and School. I have attended Salem since kindergarten. The book of Revelations was written by John the Elder in 96 AD. This book was written to comfort persecuted Christians. This verse is to comfort us by stating, even though we can't always remain faithful, Jesus fulfills the law to remain faithful for us. This verse is law that if we don't try to be faithful through life, God will punish us and we won't have eternal life with Jesus, but rather with Satan. The gospel of this verse is stated clearly. John the Elder states that if we try to stay faithful, with Jesus' help, we will still get to have eternal life in heaven with our Savior who died for us. As long as we stayed faithful to him, he died to give us the opportunity of life. I chose this verse because it stood out to me and it comforted me, knowing that if I do my best to stay faithful with Jesus' help, eternal life will be in my future. I will remember this verse every time I mess up because I will realize that God doesn't care about these little mess ups. As long as we try to believe in him, he will still accept us. This verse will keep me faithful in God for my life, push me to do my best, even though I know in the end God will still accept me.
Hi, my name is Stephen Bishop, and my verse is Psalm 27, verse 1. The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life, of whom shall I be afraid? When King David wrote these words, it was during the rebellion of Absalom. Psalms was written for the hymn book of the Old Testament Jews. I learned in this verse that I can always rely on Jesus for anything and everything that I could ever ask for. Through him, anything is possible. Jesus promises to be there for us even when we need it, and that our sin is his sin, and that cannot be changed. He helps those who believe in him and those who don't believe in him. Jesus helps everyone in need. Jesus promises he loves us and will never stop loving us. He wants us to know that he is always there for us, even when we think he isn't there. I chose this verse because it reminds me that Jesus is always there for me when I need it the most. It shows me that I always have someone by my side and I can always count on him to help me. I know that Jesus is always my friend and he will never stop being my friend. When I think of my verse and I think of Jesus, I remember that all my sins will be forgiven and go away. When I put Jesus at the center of my life, I become a stronger and better person than ever, with his power and glory. That is why I chose this verse and why it means so much to me.
I'm John Brown, and my verse is Proverbs 3:5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. The book of Proverbs was written mostly by King Solomon around 700 BC. King Solomon wanted to share the knowledge that God gave him with anyone who desired wisdom. This book was written before Jesus was born. However, God's plan for our salvation was already in motion. David and Solomon both knew that we needed a Savior, not only for themselves, but for all people. In today's world, you can't trust anyone. Faith is the complete trust in someone or something, And that is what God wants us to have in Him. We can't fully have faith in Jesus and His saving work without the Holy Spirit. As Martin Luther explained, I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in Jesus Christ my Lord, or come to Him, but the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel, enlightened me with His gifts, sanctified and kept me in the true faith. Before I chose it, I knew I wanted my verse to be about trusting in God. We put our trust in many things, family, politicians, teachers, healthcare workers, and especially ourselves. Above all these things, God is the only one who is completely faithful. He won't lie, deceive, abandon, or fail us. There is no reason not to trust God, but we still don't, because we are sinners. We can stay in His Word, pray, go to church, and remember Him in everything we do as often as we can, but we will also, however, inevitably fail, often, every day. We will fail, but God will make our path straight and lead us to life forever in His kingdom.
My name is Trinity Burns. My confirmation verse is from Psalm 50, verse 15. It says, "And call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me." The book of Psalms was written by various people, including King David and Asaph. This book was written from the 11th to 6th century BC. Events like the reign of Saul, David, Solomon, the first Olympic Games, and the Phoenicians creating an alphabet occurred during this time. There isn't a main reason on why it was written, but for the believers of God to study. The meaning of the verse is if you are struggling and need help, you can call to Jesus for it, but praise Him for it. The possible law of this verse is to thank Jesus for the help He is giving to you. Relating to the gospel, Jesus died to save us from our sin because He loves us, and we are welcome to get more help from Him if we ask for it. There have been many times when I have felt scared about things related to school or certain parts of life. During these times, I pray to God to help me through them. I've done well through all of what has happened to me, thanks to Him. I don't know what is in store for me in the future, but I have to have faith in Jesus and ask for help whenever I may need it. This is what the verse means to me.
For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper, not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Hi, my name is Ellie Busher, and my confirmation verse is Jeremiah 29, verse 11. The book of Jeremiah was written from 627 BC to around 582 BC. During this time, the kingdom of Judah was reaching its final years. The words written in the book of Jeremiah were written for the Israelites to warn them what would happen if they did not follow God's laws. In Jeremiah 29, verse 11, God wants us to know that He will always have a plan for our lives, and that plan will always be good for us. And He will be there through the ups and downs in our lives and will never leave our side. There will always be suffering and death in our lives because of sin. But this verse reassures us that throughout all the grieving and suffering in our lives, as long as we have faith in God, our hope and future will be with Jesus Christ, our Savior. Ever since I've been thinking of what I want my confirmation verse to be, Jeremiah 29:11 has always popped into mind. As some of you may or may not know, before I was born, both of my grandmas passed away, and then just this year, my great aunt, who was like a grandma to me, also passed away. Through this time, I was doubting and questioning what God had done, but then I remembered Jeremiah 29:11. I remember that God always has a reason for the good and bad things that happen in my life, and He always has a plan. Throughout my life, I will go through many ups and downs, but I know that life with Christ in the end is greater than anything that will happen in my life.
The verse I chose was Psalm 46, verse 1. The verse is, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. This book of the Bible was written by King David. The time frame was 5th century BC. This psalm was written to encourage God's people to trust and have faith in Him in times of trouble. Faith means that we believe even when things look bad, we can trust in God's plan. Because He sent Jesus into the world to die for us. He is there to rescue us, and I know this because He rescued me. When I was 8, I had a friend named Brian. We went to school together. We had lunch and played at recess every day. It was a great friendship, but then in October, Brian died suddenly. I couldn't believe it, and wanted him to be back with me. I felt lost for the first time. The next year, I kept searching for a friend like Brian and started feeling sad every day. I had a group of kids that didn't like me and made sure I knew it. I started begging my parents to not send me to school. Then it all changed. I came to Salem. Mr. Keller made me feel welcome, and I had a group of classmates that were all nice. The class would sit together and talk at lunch. Even kids in different grades would talk to me. Everyone made me feel welcome. I started to feel good, and I had found what I needed. No one could replace Brian, but God had given me help and led me the way. So what I learned is that God has a plan for me, and He never left my side. I didn't understand why things happen the way they do, but I know that God is my strength and my refuge, and He is very present help in trouble. In Brian's obituary, he is described as being a friend to all. I think that's what God wants us all to be. I will always remember Brian, and I know that Jesus rescued him. He rescued me. He does it every day, even when I don't deserve it. He shows us the way. Thank you to my Salem friends for being a part of my story. You showed the love of Jesus to me.
Hi, my name is Trinity Nixon. The verse that spoke to me is Matthew 5:16, when Jesus said, "In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." Jesus said this at the Sermon on the Mount. It was written in the New Testament. It was taught to crowds of people who followed him. My Bible verse, Matthew 5:16, told the people to do good things for other people because they would see that God's people were kind of loving as God was kind of loving to them. My Bible verse tells us to do the same. My Bible verse also tells people that God expects us to be kind and loving. That isn't a suggestion, but an expectation. Jesus treated everybody he came across with love and kindness. His biggest act of love was him dying on the cross to save us from sin and death. My Bible verse is meaningful to me because it tells me that by being kind and loving to others, I am showing how kind and loving God is. My Bible verse helps me remember that I should be kind to everyone, especially to those who don't believe in God, so that they will see that He is kind and loving. I feel like the easiest way to spread God's love is to show love and kindness in God's name. I could help people at my school, give compliments to lots of people, and help my grandparents to show that kindness. My Bible verse helps me remember that God is kind and loving.
Hi, my name is Trent Nemitz, and my verse is 1 John 4:19. We love because He first loved us. I believe this is an important verse because it shows that the Lord Jesus, our Savior, loved us before we could love each other. This verse is believed to have been written between AD 85 through 95. This offers faith and certainty in Christ. This passage was addressed to believers between 85 and 100 AD. The author of this passage was John the Apostle, also author of the Gospel and John in Revelation. John was also a disciple of Jesus whom he loved. The meaning of this verse is to show how Jesus has always loved us and did so by dying on the cross for our sins. The Lord tells us about himself in this verse. He says he loves all his believers no matter what their sins are because he forgave them. From this verse, Jesus wants us to know that we are always loved. Jesus wants us to experience that we sin, but sins are forgiven because He died for us, our salvation. God wants us to believe that all things are possible through Christ because He loves us. 1 John 4:19 will affect me specifically by knowing that God created believers to love and have relationships with each other because we were first loved. This passage will help me strengthen my faith in Christ by knowing and believing that God has a place for me in heaven because I am loved. This also means everyone is loved by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This verse will help me shape and further my Christian life by knowing that I will always be loved by Jesus through Christ and the forgiveness of sins. I will be loved by God.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above. all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Hi, my name is Jordan. My confirmation verse is Philippians 3 verse 14. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Paul the Apostle wrote this book of the Bible. Philippians 3 was written during the time period, mid-50s to early 60s, AD. This book was originally written for the Christians in Philippi. The meaning of this verse in God's perspective is that he will guide us through our way to heaven to be with him in his kingdom of glory. Our goal on our path as Christians is that God will guide us toward our goal of being with him for eternity. The law is expressed by saying we press on toward our goal. We may not follow the correct path, and that's our sinful nature. And in the gospel, God says he will call upon us by name, bringing us into his kingdom forever. He's our Savior. He's forgave our sins and helps us get to him. I personally chose this verse because at the time, my great aunt was having some difficulties, and I have been through a lot, especially through my middle school years. When I went to my great aunt's funeral, she had chosen the verse Philippians 3 verse 15, which made me think I should definitely use this verse. No matter how much I struggle daily and mentally, God will always guide me through rough times and help me grow stronger. He will help me know what is the right life path. This verse will help me when I need to look back on how far I have made it from just a small kid to a grown woman, and how much God has given me and helped me when I wasn't in the best state of being.
When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." John 8 verse 12. My name is Nathan Spear, and John 8 verse 12 is my confirmation verse. The Gospel of John was written by the Apostle John between 90 and 100 AD. The Gospel of John was written only a few years prior to when the Christian Bishop of Rome, Clement, supported his authority among other Christian communities by linking God with Rome. John wrote this book to mostly Jewish house churches in Ephesus. John was meant to evangelize Gentiles and strengthen the faith of Christians. John 8 verse 12 was written to show that Jesus is the light of the world. This means that whoever does not trust and believe in him will walk in the darkness of sin, death, and the devil. Those who have faith in Jesus and follow him will receive God's promises of eternal life and salvation. Jesus is in control of this world. And because of this, we should place our trust in him. He loves us and will care for us. In difficult times like now with the global pandemic, we can often be confused about who to trust. We can often forget that Jesus is in control of the world. He loves us and will use these difficult experiences to bring us closer to him. A good way to visualize our lives is like a tapestry. If you look at the back, all you see is a mess of strings. Turn it around, and you see a beautiful work of art. John 8 verse 12 reminds me that God is in control, no matter what circumstance I may be going through. Thank you.
Let's hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Hebrews 10, verse 23. Hello, my name is Kent Trong. Paul the Apostle wrote this book, Hebrews, in the Bible. He wrote this for Jewish Christians, and this book was written in the 1st century AD. The purpose of this verse was it teaches us that we have to be confident in the Lord Jesus and that he has a plan for mankind's salvation. Also, this verse shows that he has a plan for everybody. The gospel is that we trust in Jesus Christ because the promise he has for us is faithful. The law is that to have hope in Jesus and not to be weak in your confidence in him. This verse points Jesus as our Savior because it teaches us that we have to be confident that he is the Savior. The reason why I chose this verse is because I came back to Salem. I kind of lost touch with my faith. This verse helped in telling me that I was those non-believers and that I needed to believe. I will always remember this because this verse is like the beginning of why and how I started believing in Jesus Christ. This will help guide me through life by reminding me that Jesus is always there and because I have faith in him. Because of this verse, I know he will always be with me. Bye.
Whoever tries to keep their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life will preserve it. Luke 17:33. My name is Kevin Tron and I attend Salem Lutheran School as an 8th grader. The person who wrote the book of the Bible was Luke. The book was written between 59 through 70 AD. It was written to give believers an accurate story of Jesus' life, ministry, resurrection, and death. He got information from witnesses. The purpose of this verse, whoever tries to keep their life will soon lose it when they die, but whoever loses a life on earth will preserve it, because the result and sin are separated from God. The law of this verse is that on earth to serve God's purpose. Whoever tries to keep their life wants to live for themselves. We do not belong to ourselves, we belong to God. And he can decide what happens. The gospel of this verse, whoever loses their life will preserve it. This points to Jesus Christ our Savior, because if we live for the purpose of Christ, then we will be given eternal life as the reward. I chose this verse because the words gave me a better understanding of God, also a better understanding of his purpose, that of all my anxieties and fears, that there's more than what I see. I will probably remember this because of the research and the fact I'm living for a purpose. Well, it'll guide me through the future to remind me that this is all God's plan.
Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. John 14:6. My name is Dylan Verlieb, and that is my confirmation verse. That is the Bible verse that will be with me for the rest of my life. John wrote that verse after hearing Jesus speak those words to Thomas, after he said to Jesus that they don't know where they're going once they die. Jesus responded with those words. John wrote his book of the Bible because he wanted people to know that Jesus was the Son of God. In the verse, Jesus tells Thomas that the only way to get to God is through Jesus first. That's all he asked of us in that verse, is that we believe in him. Why him? Because he died for our sins. God sent his Son so that we could all be saved. I chose this verse because it sums up a lot of the Christian faith. It's both the law and the gospel in one verse. It reminds you who came to earth to save everyone, how I remember it. Anytime I pray, I always say, in Jesus' name, amen. That's just enough to remind me who I'm praying to. This verse will guide me in life, remind me that the only important things are not my earthly belongings. I don't have to worry about those things as much because I know there's something much more important waiting for me, heaven and eternal life, because of Jesus.
Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. These words come from the Bible verse Hebrews 13:8. My name is Peter, and the Hebrews 13:8 is my Bible verse. This book of the Bible was written by the Apostle Paul during the first century. During this period, Europe, North America, and Near East fell under increasing domination by the Roman Empire. These words of the Bible were written for the Jewish Christians that lived in Jerusalem. In this Bible verse, we learn that our Lord Jesus Christ will never change and will always be the same. The gospel expressed in this verse is that Jesus Christ will always be the same to save us. The law expressed in this verse is that we believe in Jesus Christ because he will never change. The Lord wants us to know that Jesus Christ will always be the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. This verse points to Jesus Christ as our Savior by telling us that Jesus doesn't change. This verse is meaningful to me personally because it was taught to me when I was about 5 years old, and I've always lived by it ever since because it's true. This verse can help my faith in Christ grow by reminding me that Jesus Christ will always be the same and will never change. I will apply this to my daily life by knowing that Jesus Christ from Abraham's time will always be the same, will always be with me, and will never change. This Bible verse will always have meaning to me throughout my life because even when I grow up, Jesus will always be the same and will never change.
Please stand for the prayer of the day. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, merciful Father, since you have wakened from death the shepherd of your sheep, grant us your Holy Spirit, that when we hear the voice of our shepherd, we may know him who calls us each by name, and follow where he leads, through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Please join in the reading of the evening prayer by Martin Luther.
I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me this day.
And I pray that you would forgive me all my sins where I have done wrong, and graciously keep me this night. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless and preserve you. Amen.